Good morning again.
Good morning.
Thank you, Dorothy, for that. It was beautiful. Well, if you would like to, you can turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 3. I believe it'll be on the screen as well, but I'll be reading from the New Living Translation, so if you'd rather just read along on the screen, you're free to do that as well. But let's start there in Genesis chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals that God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" "Of course, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden," the woman replied. "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. When the cool evening breezes were blowing and the man and his wife heard the Lord walking about in the garden, so they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Then the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He replied, "I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. I was afraid because I was naked." "Who told you that you were naked?" the Lord God asked. "Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat?" The man replied, "It was the woman you gave me who gave me the fruit, and I ate it." Then the Lord God asked the woman, "What have you done?" "The serpent deceived me," she replied. "That's why I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all animals, domestic and wild. You will crawl on your belly, groveling in the dust as long as you live. And I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Then he said to the woman, "I will sharpen the pain of your pregnancy, and in pain you will give birth, and you will desire to control your husband, but he will rule over you." And to the man he said, "Since you listened to your wife and ate from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat, the ground is cursed because of you. All your life you will struggle to scratch a living from it. It will grow thorns and thistles for you. Though you will eat of its grains, by the sweat of your brow will you have food to eat, until you return to the ground from which you were made. For you were made from dust, and to dust you will return." Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for the truth that it speaks. I pray, Father, that you would give me your words this morning, not mine, but yours. Lord, that we would all hear directly from you through your Holy Spirit. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Most of us here probably know this story really well. We've heard it since we were children, in Sunday school class, in church. We hear it even in school from time to time, because there's the constant debate of how the world began. And creation inevitably always comes up with the story of Adam and Eve. So we all know this story really well, but there's a few things I want to point out that kind of gave me a fresh perspective on the world we live in today, and the things that we seem to struggle with day in and day out. More than sin entered the world that day. You can see that as God describes what life will be like for mankind and all of creation from then on, you can see it in Adam and Eve's reaction after they sinned, that more than sin entered the world that day. But I'd like to touch on three things in particular that seem to be alive and well today, even among those of us who call ourselves believers. But first, I want to point out something very interesting that was brought to my attention by author and pastor David Platt. Look at the opening pages of human history, and you will see the ultimate problem of the human heart. When God creates man, God puts him in a Garden of Eden and says, "You're free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die." Here we see God's holiness, his goodness, his justice, and grace on display. God has authority to define what is right and wrong, and good and evil, based on his pure and holy character. God makes clear to man that he will be judged based upon his obedience to the command that God has given. God's grace is evident, for he does not hide his law. In love, God tells man the way to life and exhorts him to walk in it. So how does the created respond to the creator? Within a matter of only a few verses, temptation to sin sits on the table. The serpent asks the first woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Do you see the role reversal there? It all begins when the command of God is reduced to questions about God. Is God really holy? Does he really know what's right? Is God really good? Does he really want what's best for me? Amidst such questions, man and woman subtly assert themselves not as the ones to be judged by God, but as the ones who sit in judgment of him. The serpent's question revolves around the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. We may read the tree's name and think, well, what's wrong with knowing the difference between good and evil? But the meaning of Scripture here goes beyond information about good and evil to the determination of good and evil. In other words, for the man and woman to eat from this tree was to reject God as the one who determines what is good and evil, and to assume that responsibility upon themselves. The temptation in the garden was to rebel against God's authority, and in the process, make humans the judge of morality. That's what happened in the garden. So, that's why our world is in the state that it's in today. Because it was less about knowing the difference between good and evil. The real meaning is they made themselves the judge of what was good and evil themselves. Because one day, thousands of years ago, man and woman decided that they wanted to decide for themselves what was right and wrong. Man and woman decided that they wanted to be the authority rather than allowing the true authority to have his rightful place. Which leads me to the first thing I want to talk about today. What was the first thing that tempted Eve? It was the desire for control. To know and decide for herself. She wanted that power. To be the god of her own life. And Adam, too, followed suit. I bet if I were to ask how many of you would be honest this morning, honest enough to show by raising your hand that you are a self-proclaimed control freak. That only some of you would raise your hands. We have spouses raising hands for their spouses. Only some of you would raise your hand. And I bet that some of us would raise our hands proudly because we are proud of our control freak issue. But let's face it, whether we raise our hands or not, all of us at one point or another, and even now, want and like to have control. And in some ways, have flaunted that fact about ourselves. We have even given it a funny name and joke about it when we talk about being control freaks. We just say, oh, that's how I am, or that's how they are, and we typically blame it on all kinds of things from our past, be it our upbringing or past experiences or whatever. We excuse ourselves to be that way. We might be products of our past, but we aren't supposed to be prisoners to it. In other words, our past should no longer define who we are and how we behave, because Jesus Christ and new life in him is now our defining thing. Let's just be honest here for a minute. We all know that women struggle with control issues. God even said it in verse 16 of what we just read. You will desire to control your husband, but he will rule over you. Life would just be so much easier, wouldn't it, ladies, if we could control our husbands? But just in case you thought you were off the hook, guys, men have control issues too. I mean, let's face it, men like having power. Why else would an entire nation of men identify with this man?
possibly from the Big Bad Man.
Before I found that clip, I asked my husband to do that grunt for me, and he had it down. So, but what was the catchphrase that he always attached to those grunts? What was it? Do you remember? More power. Always. More power. Whoa, whoa, whoa. I can't even do it. I just butchered that. But more power. Why else would an entire nation of men identify with him? And how about what we fondly call OCDs? For both men and women, for all of us, we joke about the OCDs that we have. But what do OCD compulsions come back to at the root? A desire to control your environment and the people in it. And what about using our emotions to control people? Many men use their anger to control people. Women use their expertise in manipulation through crying and pouting to control people. Children use temper tantrums to control people. I see it every day in preschool. But we're not alone. All throughout Scripture, we see people with control issues. I think of Abraham and Sarah waiting for their promised child and how they took control of the situation because they didn't want to wait anymore. I think of King David, who took advantage of his authority by taking another man's wife and having her husband murdered. I think of Jonah, who wanted so badly to control whether an entire city would repent and return to God that he ran away and refused to speak the truth to them. And even after God had him swallowed by a whale and then vomited up on land, and he finally did what God told him to do, and the entire city repented, Jonah remained angry at God for saving them. That book does not end on a good note. It ends with Jonah sitting under a tree complaining at God for saving the people of Nineveh. And then I think of Job's friend, Elihu, who flat out says in Job 34:4, "Let us discern for ourselves what is right." Why is it that we think that we know better than God? Why is it that we can look at a situation and try to fix it ourselves instead of letting God be God? Why do we try to take the authority for ourselves that belongs to Him alone? Sometimes we get involved in something that we should never have gotten involved with in the first place to try to prove something. It reminds me of a story that I heard several years back. In 1999, a Vermont native found himself in a difficult position while touring the Eagles Rock African Safari Zoo with a group from St. Petersburg, Russia. Ronald went to extremes to demonstrate the power of Crazy Glue, one of America's many marvels, to the Russians. To prove the effectiveness of Crazy Glue, he rubbed several ounces of the adhesive onto the palms of his hands and jokingly placed them on the rear end of a passing rhino. The rhinoceros, a resident of the zoo for 13 years, was not initially startled, but you know, the rhino had been a part of the petting zoo for quite a long time, since it was a baby, so it wasn't initially startled. However, once it became aware of being involuntarily stuck to Ronald, it began to panic and charge wildly about the petting area with Ronald as an unwitting passenger. What Ron didn't realize was that Sally the rhino hadn't been feeling well. She was constipated and had just been given a laxative when the American played his prank. During Sally's tirade, a shed wall was gored, two fences destroyed, and a number of small animals escaped. Three pygmy goats and one duck were stomped to death. During the stampede and subsequent capture, Sally began to feel the effects of the laxative, showering Ronald repeatedly with over 30 gallons of rhino diarrhea. I guess you could say that Ron was ended up to his neck. We have no business God, once again, has to fix it and make it right. Control can show up in a variety of ways and circumstances. From not allowing others to help you with something because you've taken ownership over it and it's yours, to wanting to control your kids because then you know they'll be safe from harm or won't make bad decisions that you did, to wanting to take charge of a situation that is spinning out of control and you're tired of praying and seeing no difference, to you're tired of waiting for God to do something, to you name it. You name the situation. The reality is probably right now there is something that all of us in this room are feeling that we want to control. We know what or who it is. It pops into our mind all the time. Well, I can fix this. Come on, God, what's taking you so long? All joking about OCDs and Tim Taylor aside, here's the truth. Though it looks different in all of our lives, we are all just like the man and woman in the garden. We think, even if God tells me to wait and trust him, if he doesn't do something soon, I'm going to do it my way. Or we think, even if God tells me not to do something in his word, I'm going to do it anyway. He'll forgive me. And besides, that command isn't really legitimate for today. Or we think, I know God wants me to wait for him, but I can do this on my own. In essence, we're saying, God's not Lord over me, and God doesn't know what's best for me. I define what's right and wrong, and good and evil. And we shift from the firm, unchanging truth that we find in God's word to the creative notions of our own human minds, just like Adam and Eve did. It becomes whatever feels or seems right for me is right for me. Essentially, it's all about me. For what is power and control rooted in but self? That's why the Bible says in Romans 3:12 that we all turn aside to ourselves. In the essence of what the Bible calls sin is the exaltation of self. God has designed us to put him first in our lives, others next, and ourselves last. Yet sin reverses the order. We put ourselves first, others next, many times in an attempt to use them for ourselves, and God last. We turn from worshiping God to worshiping self. Control is rooted in the worship of self. We think we know best and that we can do it the best. But that's why Jesus came. Yes, to conquer sin and death and to have a relationship once again with his creation, but also to abolish self. To put God the Father back into his rightful place of authority over our lives. Jesus says in Mark 8:34, then, calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me. And then he says in Matthew 10:38-39, if you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. Do you know what it means to take up our cross and deny our selfish ways? It means to not only give up sin, it means to give up what we want. It means that we give up our own will and ultimately the control desire that we have. And Jesus knew that we would struggle with this because elsewhere Jesus says that we must deny our selfish ways and take up our cross every day. Every day, not just when we get saved, but every day after that. When we give our lives to Christ, we aren't just receiving forgiveness for our sins, we're making him Lord over our lives. We're giving him the authority to determine what is right and wrong and good and evil in our lives. We're trusting his abilities instead of our own. We're putting him first instead of ourselves. We are relinquishing control. Now, I'm not standing here today as someone who never struggles with control issues or as someone who has no OCDs, because I do have a few little quirks and my husband can make you very aware of them. But according to these verses in Mark and Matthew, Jesus takes denying ourselves pretty seriously. So it's time to stop taking it so lightly and realize that when we behave this way, we're clinging to the old person when we're supposed to be the new person, who Jesus came to die to make it happen. What does Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 say? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. Trust in God, not your own understanding. Why did God say that? Because He knows that our understanding is limited. Seek His will, and He will show you where to go and what to do. Seek Him. When we're faced with a circumstance or a person that we're dealing with that we don't know how to deal with, and we're frustrated, and we're angry, or we're sorrowful, the first thing that we should do is take it to God. We shouldn't sit there and think, how can I fix this? What can I do? How do I make this better? It's not about you. It's not about me. It's about what God will do in that situation. So as soon as we're faced with that, we go to God and say, God, what would you have me do in this situation? The second thing that was ushered into the world was fear. And you see this almost immediately. In verse 10, it says that Adam hid because he was afraid. It's why we see in the Bible time and time again God telling His people not to be afraid. We live in a world where the primary emotion is one of fear. Just look at the climate of our country right now. We're all living in fear. What's the economy going to do? What's a new president going to do? How am I going to keep my job? The climate in our culture is fear. People who are working fear being out of work. Married couples fear being alone as they get older. Single people fear being alone for the rest of their lives. If you're healthy, you fear becoming ill. If you're ill, you fear you're never going to be healthy again. To some extent, fear is even used to control children. Oh, don't do that, because this will happen. You better behave, or Santa's not going to bring you anything. Oftentimes, you hear it even among Christians in our churches. It's seen. Sadly, the world can't really see a difference in believers when it comes to fear. Even more sad is that we have the answer for all fear in Jesus Christ, and we're afraid to share it with others because we don't know what kind of reaction we're going to get. We're afraid to speak the truth, even if it's different than what our culture teaches, because we might get persecuted or sued or whatever. Oftentimes, you hear that fear paralyzes people, and sometimes it does. But I'm here to tell you that fear actually motivates people. Most of the time. Think about it. Fears of what will happen with our economy motivate us to invest one way or the other, or not at all. Fears of commitment motivate many people to stay single and shun any chance of being in a relationship. Fears of failure motivate us to never try to do something or anything that requires risk. Fear of rejection motivate us to become like everyone else so that we never really have our own identity. We just want to blend in with the crowd and become like everybody else. Fears of flying motivate us to drive or ride the bus or take the train, anything to get on a plane. Fears of being alone motivate us to surround ourselves with people all the time. Fear of gaining weight motivates people to obsessively work out, eat very little, or even binge and purge to stay thin. Fear of public speaking or being in front of people motivates us to work behind the scenes where no one can see us or judge us and refuse to do anything that requires us to be up front. Fears of death motivates us to live extra cautious lives and to avoid conversations about death. I could go on forever. But one thing is clear. Fear always motivates. Let's just, for fun, let's shout out some ideas of fears that people struggle with in life. Just shout them out. Go ahead. Say them out loud enough that everybody can hear.
Fear of the dark.
Fear of the dark. What else?
Water.
Fear of water. What else? Lightning, okay. What else?
Commitment.
Cockroaches.
Commitment.
Huh?
Commitment. Commitment.
Failure, commitment. What else?
Heights.
Good one. Okay, so I want you for a moment to think of your deepest fear. Your own individual deepest fear. Just get it in your mind. Everybody got it? Okay, I want to tell you something. Don't be afraid! There, that should have fixed it, right? I told you not to be afraid, that should have fixed it, right? Right? It should just be gone now. Actually, no. It doesn't work that way, does it? Somebody can tell you to not be afraid till they're blue in the face, and it's not going to work. Those four words are meaningless without the because that God gives us at the end of that sentence in Scripture. Because when God told his people, do not be afraid, he always added a promise on the end of that command. I'm going to give you a few of them found in Scripture. Do not be afraid because the Lord your God will be with you. Do not be afraid because I am your shield and great reward. Do not be afraid because I am with you and will bless you. Do not be afraid because I will make you. Do not be afraid because I will deliver you. Do not be afraid because I will deliver them into your hands. Do not be afraid because I will fight for you. Do not be afraid because I will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid because I will be with you wherever you go. Do not be afraid because I will not fail you. Do not be afraid because the battle belongs to me. Do not be afraid because there is greater power with me. Do not be afraid because I myself will help you. Do not be afraid because I will rescue you. Do not be afraid because I will strengthen you. Do not be afraid because I have done great things. Do not be afraid because your prayer has been heard. Do not be afraid because I am the first and the last. Do not be afraid because I will give you life. All those promises are found in Scripture, and that's not even all of them. But when God tells us do not be afraid, he puts a promise on the other end of it. And they can all be summed up like this. Do not be afraid because I am is here. The power to overcome fear isn't in the command to not be afraid. The power to overcome fear is in the promise tied to the command. Two hunters were out hunting and came upon what appeared at first as an abandoned farm. The barn was sagging, the house was in disrepair, and there were junk cars and car parts lying around. The only thing that made it a working farm were a few chickens pecking away and a goat wandering around. As they entered the yard, they came across an old well. One asked the other, I wonder how deep it is. The other said, well, we'll have to drop something down and listen for the splash. They looked and found close by an old transmission. They hauled it over to the well and dropped it in. They counted and waited a long time before the splash came. It was one deep well, all right. As they turned to leave, they saw the goat charging at them, head down, horns headed straight for them. At the last moment, they jumped aside, and the goat went right past them and straight over the side and down into the well. They looked at each other in shock, not knowing what to do. So they started to leave. Then the owner of the farm came walking up. They chatted for a moment and got permission to hunt on his land. And then the farmer asked, have you seen my goat? And they said, well, your goat almost killed us, man. He charged right at us. You should have had that goat tied up. And the farmer said, I thought I had him tied up to an old transmission. See, like the goat, we follow what we're tied to. Are you tied to the promises of God, or are you tied to your fears? Are you living in fear, or in the strength and confidence of the great I am? The third and most damaging thing that was ushered into the world that day so long ago was shame. Or actually, a better word is guilt. The moment Adam and Eve sinned, mankind was found guilty. And you see the weight of it immediately. In verse 7, you see that as soon as their eyes were opened, they felt shame. And all throughout Scripture, we read about the guilt of mankind. From the Old Testament, clear through the New Testament. But Jesus came to take away our guilt. And here's the crazy thing. We sin, we repent, God forgives us through the blood of Christ and removes our guilt. But we don't forgive ourselves. Therefore, we continue to struggle with guilt that we're not meant to have in our life. When we hang on to guilt, it's like saying to God, "Sorry, God, but I need to be punished a little longer, so I'm not going to let go of this guilt. You just forgave me way too easily." But my friends, guilt is never a good thing. Guilt can be used to lead us to repentance, but guilt is always harmful. Either it's harmful because we're guilty of sin before God, which puts our relationship with Him and eternity at risk, or it's harmful because we continue to live in it even after we've been forgiven. There is an accuser, Satan. And he loves it when we live in either of these forms of guilt. Because guilt leads to being ashamed of who we are. And feelings of defeat and depression and fear, even self-destruction. Even believers become obsessed by the memory of some sin committed years ago. It never leaves. It cripples their ministry, their devotional life, their relationship with God and others. They live in fear that someone will discover their past. They work overtime trying to prove to God that they're truly repentant. They erect barriers against the wonderful grace of God. But here's the thing. Romans 8:1 says, "So now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus." And Psalm 103:12 says, "He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west." In case you don't get the impact of these two statements, let me explain them. The east and the west can never meet in one point. They are forever the same distance from each other. So our sins are removed to an eternal distance. God has entirely put away our sins. They are so far removed that they can no longer affect us. We are safe from all condemnation for our sins, as if they had not been committed at all. Did you get that? God has so far removed and forgotten our sins that it's like we never committed them in the first place. Isaiah 43 says that God blots out our transgressions and remembers them no more. Isaiah 44 says that God has swept away our offenses and sins like a cloud or morning mist. Micah 7 says that He treads our sins under His foot and hurls all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. And yet, some of us here are living in guilt every day. You are stuck somewhere in your past, and you haven't been able to forgive yourself. I'm here to tell you that nothing that you have done is beyond God's grace and forgiveness. Nothing. I don't care what you've done. Whether you've lied, cheated, stolen, gossiped, been bitter, bragged, judged, swore, used God's name in vain. But for some reason, we don't have as hard of a time accepting God's forgiveness for those kinds of sins, do we? It's the other things that we have trouble letting go of, right? Things like if you've assaulted someone, abused someone, murdered, raped, aborted a child, had sex outside of marriage, had a child outside of marriage, been a drug addict, been an alcoholic, cheated on your spouse physically or emotionally, molested, used pornography, led someone else into sin, lusted, gambled, hated God, manipulated, been greedy, slept with someone of the same sex, been filled with jealousy or envy, wished harm on someone or wished someone was dead, rejoiced in evil, mocked or slandered, been prejudiced, been proud, caused division, prostituted yourself, been in witchcraft or sorcery, made horrible mistakes with your kids. I don't care how you have failed. Or better yet, how much you think you have failed. God's grace is sufficient. And when you come to Him and you repent of your sin and are forgiven, you are made clean and new. The old is gone. You may still have to deal with the consequences of the choices you've made, but the old person is gone. The sin is gone. The guilt is gone. Our sin is so far removed that it's like it never happened to begin with. We're made white as snow. And then, when we ask for the Holy Spirit, God gives Him freely. And do you know what the Word promises? In 2 Corinthians 3:17, it says, Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom! Freedom from sin, freedom from guilt, freedom from fear, freedom from all the control issues that you have. It's why Jesus came. Jesus said in Luke 4, quoting from Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because He has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free." I don't know where this finds you this morning. I don't know if you're imprisoned by control or fear or guilt, but what I know to be absolutely 100% true is that Jesus wants to take it up for you. He wants you to give it to Him and let Him remove it from your life. He wants to forgive you. He wants to restore you. He wants to relieve your fears. He wants to erase your guilt and shame. He wants to be put back in perfect, loving control of your life. He wants to set you free. So there's really just one question that you need to answer. Do I want to be free? If that's your desire, it's not there by coincidence. If your desire is to be free from control or fear or guilt, God put that in you so that you would come to Him and lay it down. Would everyone just bow your heads for a moment, close your eyes, all eyes closed, all heads bowed. I want to tell you that despite this room full of people, there are only two people who matter right now. You and Jesus. It doesn't matter who else is here or what they're thinking. There's an audience of one who wants your attention right now. Just sit with him for a moment. Talk to him. While our heads are bowed, if I could have the instrumentalists come up. You heard this song earlier in the service. The words will be on the screen if you desire to sing along, but as the music begins, don't hesitate. That's what Satan wants you to do. He wants you to hesitate. He wants you to think. Don't think. Just move. Kneel at your seat. Move to the altar. Stand in worship. However you feel led to respond today, just be obedient to the Holy Spirit right now. That's all I ask. Just be obedient. For there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. I encourage you this morning that if you haven't done so already, to lay it down. Don't remain in prison. Let God set you free. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. Thank you for your word, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your desire to set us free, for your love that is unconditional and unending, for your grace that is all sufficient. God, thank you. I ask this morning as we leave this place that the things that we have laid down, Father, don't let us walk out these doors and pick them back up, because we will have made a mockery of what you've just done for us. God, let us leave them in your hands and trust ourselves to your care. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.